Bringing people and communities together on secklosounds.org. Good morning and welcome to another Sticks Radio Show here on Seclo Sounds with me, Terry Sullivan. And today on the show I have as my guest, Lesley-Ann Jones. She's a novelist, broadcaster, keynote speaker and Fleet Street journalist. I'm going to have to be on my metal today. And she's just written a book a little while ago, called Imagine. And it's Where Were You the Night John Lennon Died, or the Night John Lennon Was Killed. And it tells a little story, and she's going to tell us all about that and all her other projects in a little while. But first, I couldn't resist playing this. Of course, this is John Lennon and the classic Imagine. My guest today on the show is an author. Well, she's an all-rounder, really. She's been a journalist, or is a journalist, all sorts of things. But we'll talk about it in a while. But she's got a brand new book out. It's called Imagine. The lady's name is Lesley-Ann Jones. Good morning, Lesley.
Good morning. How are you?
It's great. I've finished reading the book. It's a great read. It's a very, very much a show business read. I quite enjoyed it. And I think if you like sort of glitzy show business, murder mystery novels, I won't give too much away, you will love this.
Oh, that's very kind
yeah.
of you.
Well,
it's a labour of love, really.
Is it?
As a result of being a journalist for so many years, you know, I saw so much that I couldn't use. And I think all of that was cooking in my head for so many years and thinking, there has to be somewhere to put this, you know. And then I came up with the idea for this novel, and there's a bit of everything I've ever seen and done in this book.
So some of the stories, should we say, are, and some of the sort of excesses and some of the some of the stories are true, then, are they, with different names?
I think virtually everything is true, but
okay.
slightly exaggerated or under exaggerated. that's a word, in the other direction. All the characters are composites, so they're all made up of bits of people that I've known and worked with down the decades.
Yeah, I recognise sort of some of the characters of some of the people I've met over the years, and I've been in the sort of music business since about 1999, and the journalistic business about 1999, and I see sort of not necessarily the people perhaps you're thinking of, but should we say the characters there.
The types. There are
the types. That's the right thing.
They do conform, I think, largely. Although everybody has their quirks and their traits and their weirdness, that there are things like a manager. There is a type who becomes a manager. It's generally an ex-musician or somebody who hasn't quite made it themselves who moves into management. And there's always a bit of resentment there that they weren't able to do what they think they do better than their star.
Yeah, I must admit, I come across that quite a bit, and I must admit, if I can avoid using agents and managers to get to people, all the better for me, because of I find sometimes they're, without getting myself in too much trouble, interesting characters.
Yeah, they generally have a big chip on their shoulders.
Yeah, they could.
People often say to me, how come you got so close to so many stars back in the day?
Yeah.
I think you've just hit the nail on the head, actually. It was... There were managers around, but they weren't really the promoters, the publicists, the agents, record company people, all the hangers-on. Mm. And really, if you wanted to talk to somebody, you made contact, and they invited you round. And then if you got on, they'd say, come to dinner. And then the next week or the month after, they might invite you on the road. And it really did happen like that in the 80s and 90s.
It's an interesting story, because of I do sort of other things. I do like comparing, and I get some of the bands who come on the show, then invite me to compare their show for them, which is lovely for me. I take that as a big honour, you know. And to sort of get into their inner circle almost, which is quite nice, you know, because I'm sort of very relaxed the way I do things. And so let's talk about the book. I won't give too much away, but the very very beginning, the lady who's the main character, rock journalist. She's not based on yourself by any chance?
Not actually, because I was never who she turns out to be, but go on.
Okay, no, I didn't. She witnesses John Lennon being shot.
She does.
Where did the idea of that bit come from? You weren't around when John Lennon was shot, were you?
There weren't any journalists present.
I was going to say,
nobody in the media saw it happen.
No, that's not.
But I've been working in New York quite a lot over the years, and I'd sometimes wander up to the Dakota Building because it's a landmark.
Mm-hmm.
And I went inside only once when I interviewed Lauren Bacall there years ago, and she had a flat inside.
Wow.
And, you know, it's one of those places, if you're walking up through Central Park, you might sort of duck across and have a look. It's perennially fascinating, and tourists would come by, families and couples and people with children, and they'd want to have their picture taken on the spot where John Lennon died. Mm-hmm. And this fascinated me, and it got me to thinking, what would I have done if I'd have been standing outside there that night when John was killed? Would I have just walked away and tried to forget about it and gone off and been sad, or would I have done the journalist thing and written about it and made my name?
Mm.
And that's the choice that she makes. And the action cuts to the present day, so 30 or
yeah,
later.
Cause
and it comes back to haunt her.
It does indeed. We won't give too much away, because we want people to read the book.
Sure.
The reason you sort of probably touched on it, the reason John Lennon was an influence on your life, or is it just because you saw this, you didn't choose somebody else the night somebody else died?
Well, it was a major world event, wasn't it?
It was indeed.
Kind of kicked off a series of ideas in my mind, and in fact I was beginning to work on a sequel to this one, and then I thought, actually there's a bigger theme here. I could take any number of real life world events and use them as a backdrop for my stories.
Mm.
And that is going to be the plan. I was just about to start working on the next one when sadly David Bowie died, and that took me off in a whole other direction.
I know, we'll mention that actually in a little while. I mean, we've lost countless celebrities this year. It's been not a good year, 2016. It's not been a great year. So there is going to be an Imagine 2 or another one with Nina Vincent in.
I'm on a roll now with that particular theme. Yes, I want to explore that some more.
Well, I think it would work. I mean, we'll talk about there's three main characters, there's actually four, isn't there, really? But there's Nina. She's the rock journalist. Then you've got James, who's her estranged husband. Then you've got Charlie, who is her son, who's quite a character as well. Where did the Where did you get this sort of the three characters from? You probably told me already. The sort of people you are they people you've met over the years, or sort of caricatures of people you met over the years?
I think you don't get to be as old as I am without having met all kinds of people in your life, and I've lived and worked in a number of countries, and met, you know, the full range of what there can be, all the different kinds of husbands, all the different kinds of kids. And I wanted to create some red herrings for the tragedies that happen throughout the story and to maintain the thriller element, really. So I had to come up with some pretty strong characters who could carry the story. And those are just two that you mentioned. There are others.
Yeah, there are quite a few. I mean, who would you say is your writing heroes? Who do you sort of read and get your inspiration from?
Years ago, I was sent to interview Jackie Collins at the Ritz, and I just had a baby, and I was feeding the baby myself, and so I couldn't leave her, but I also couldn't stop working. So I checked with the PR people, and this was fine. I rocked up to the Ritz with my brand new baby, and Jackie seized upon her and sat cuddling her while I interviewed her, and I thought this was so incredibly stylish. I was about to write to her and thank her for this particular afternoon. Before I got the chance to, I received a letter from her delivered to the Daily Mail, where I was working at the time, on printed in embossed royal blue on cream vellum notepaper, Jackie Collins at the Ritz. And I looked at this piece of notepaper and thought, I have to have this. And she was so incredibly kind and such a fantastic storyteller. Mm-hmm. And she was the one who said to me, write what you know. You know, don't look around for inspiration in areas of life that you really haven't had any experience of, but write about what you know. And she was my original inspiration for writing. Her and Faye Weldon, who, you know, she's a novelist who is extremely imaginative and takes things off into surreal realms. And I haven't got there yet. So I think if I could be any kind of writer, it would be a combination of Jackie Collins and Faye Weldon.
Well, yeah, I mean, I can see to a certain amount. I just wondered about the murder, because there's the sort of murder mystery element of it as well, isn't there? Which Jackie Collins, to my recollection, doesn't do murder mystery. It's normally the starred World is Full of Married Men and a few other books, isn't there? And Faye Weldon, sort of, she does like Life and Loves of the She-Devil and things like that. She's not really a murder mystery. So it's slight. So you've added the murder mystery element in.
Yeah, I don't know why I went for that, really. I mean, I haven't got too down and gory with it.
No, you haven't.
You don't think?
No, it's not too bad. I mean, let's sort of run through the plot a little bit. Nina witnesses the murder of John Lennon. She has two choices: forget about it or write about it. And she writes about it. And then 30 years on, she is called the worst lady of Fleet Street. She's got a mercurial editor, an estranged husband, and a psychological compromised son. And she also has a best friend who's a weary police detective. And basically, what happens, a group of A-list rockers are murdered in, well, all over the world, basically, aren't they?
Yeah, they are, and that's what confounds the plot, really, because Interpol doesn't stand a chance. And all these police forces in different countries are not talking to each other, primarily because they speak different languages. So there's no way that these murders can really be properly investigated.
Mm. And it's literally all over the world. And without giving too much away, Nina's diaries get stolen, and her son, who she thinks has stolen the diaries, and is uncovering her past, and she thinks he might be the killer, and she's the next victim. But I won't give too much away by not mentioning any more.
Very kind. I think the overriding theme really is a middle-aged woman confronting herself.
I think so, and her demons, perhaps we could say.
Yes, it's exactly that. It's her demons, her past. Her past has all come back around to haunt her. I think this happens to all of us in middle age. But I've exaggerated the scenarios, obviously, and also the characters, although I'd have to say that rock stars really don't need very much exaggeration. They pretty much are as they come.
They are indeed. I have the pleasure of meeting a few of them, and I sort of work in the same, not the quite as high profile as you do. I work in the next level down of rock stars, and some of them are interesting characters. And
to say the least.
Without getting myself into too much trouble and not having any more guests on the show, you can have some interesting times with them. But I mean, you've been an author, a commentator, a broadcaster for many years. But your dad was also a famous writer, and I remember your dad very well. Actually,
how nice of you to mention him. Thank you.
I remember him very well. When I was a young boy, when I was at home, mum and dad used to